Good morning and welcome. Today is the 13th of February 2015, otherwise known as Black Friday, if you will, Friday the 13th. And tomorrow is going to be Valentine's Day here in Derry, New Hampshire, where the studio is located. My name is Bob Stevens, and I've had the pleasure of doing this show now for about 8 or 10 years. Each and every guy and gal who's given their story or shared their experiences with us has left and have told me many times, boy, I carried that stuff around for a long time, and I guess I'm glad to get rid of it. For those of you who don't know, well, wait just a minute, let me do something to you. Put that down. I got this thing in the mail a couple of months ago. It's a special service telephone group, if you will, throughout the state of New Hampshire. The number to remember, now every guy and gal who served or their friends should recognize and keep this in mind. The number is 211. It'll set you in contact. You probably can't read it, but this is a cadre of the different services and people who are here to help answer any question or problems you may have. The problem, though, is that you've got to ask for it, but when you do, you'll be given all the help you possibly could need. Now, the basic requirement is had at least 6 months active duty service and were honorably discharged. If you'd have that number, 211, put it in the, it'd probably be one of the best programs or phone calls you'll ever make in your life, okay? We'll remind you again at the end of the program. Today is another chapter in what we call the Veterans History Project under the Library of Congress. Ours is called the Veterans History Forum, wherein we've asked every guy and gal who served in World War I, they're no longer with us, but World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Desert Shield, Desert Storm, Venezuela, who can and will come and share those experiences with us here in a televised interview. That information and the data paper that goes along with it will be forwarded down to the Library of Congress as part of the database and remembering of all the history. The point is two things to remember. Number one, we are recording history as it was made by the people who made it, so that there's no, if you will, spin or activity, good or bad, concerned with it. It's what the guys and gals did and the results that it had on the program. And the other thing, and this is the bottom line, it's perhaps one of the best legacies that any guy or gal who served anywhere can leave their family. It's a recording of what you did way back when that a lot of the people keep today, well, the grandkids keep asking me, hey, Grandpa, what did you do in the war? Well, the first question, you know, 90 plus, you kind of forget a few things. We find that, but okay, we'll fill in the blanks. But I had to go back and say, well, now, which war do you mean? The one I was in, World War II, then you had Korea, Vietnam, Desert Shield, Desert Storm, and more after that. Well, when you get identified as to the war you were in, and some of you served in two or three different combats. Now, the reaction, and this, again, I keep repeating it, but it is really, I think it's almost cathartic, because the people have said many times, whew, you know, I've been carrying that baggage for a hell of a long time. Thank you for helping me get rid of it. Now, I've been very fortunate, I think, and proud. I've had interviews with a lot of POWs up in the Veterans Administration here. And at the end of every one of those interviews, that was one of the best things they said, because they then could tell and show their families and their friends what they did, but more important, what they went through. Nothing Hollywood, what they actually went through to get that information out. So again, I keep saying it, all we can do is ask. But if you do, we'll give you the best treatment we can, and the best part about it is, it'll be part of the history. We have another guy today, you saw the picture at the beginning. I'll ask Gil to introduce himself, identify who he is, where he is, what he is today, and then we'll go back and find out how we got here, okay? Young man, you're on. If you will, please, give me your name, spell your last name for the record, tell us where you now live, and when you went into the service, active date and the branch of service.
Well, my name is Briggs, Gilbert Briggs, Jr., and I enlisted in the Army in December of 42, and I went down to Texas and...
Well, not too far. just the dates, if you will, for now. Where do you now live, for example? We'll get into where you did.
Where do I live?
Yeah,
I live
right
here
now.
In New Hampshire.
Where in New Hampshire?
In, you would ask that.
Okay, everything is Freeport?
My brain isn't working.
Well, here, we got it right here. I won't embarrass you, because I had to add, Fremont.
Yeah, Fremont,
there
New Hampshire.
There we go. Yeah. Excuse the French, folks. All right.
And, I lived there with my wife and my dog, Ruga, and... I am very happy and have a very good life.
Good to hear, because we talked earlier, and you say you're a happy cat, and that's good, because there aren't a lot of happy people right now.
I am a very happy
cat. Okay,
person.
Now we know where you are. We've seen what you look like way back when. Let's go back, if you will, and develop who you came to be. For example, where and when were you born? What kind of a family life did you have back in the Depression? Any of your brothers or sisters in the service? Any special things you want to talk about before you went into the service, as far as your early life?
Well, I was born in North Andover and...
Massachusetts?
In Massachusetts,
okay.
Yes.
We gotta give the people a clue.
And we moved to Providence, Rhode Island area, outside of Providence.
Okay, when were you born?
August 28th, 1923.
Thank you.
And as I was saying, we moved to Rhode Island and spent quite a few years in Rhode Island and then moved back to Massachusetts.
Any reason for the move down and back? Just working
work.
To get a job?
It was jobs.
Yeah, okay, back in
my parents worked in the wool and worsted industry.
Oh, okay.
And they originally were here in Massachusetts working in the wood and air mills. And then they moved, as I said, down to Rhode Island. When the mills shut down here, they moved to Rhode Island and worked in the mills in Rhode Island.
Now, was this during the Depression or just before the Depression?
This was after the Depression.
After the Depression, okay.
Yep. And we stayed in Rhode Island not a very long time, probably 2 or 3 years, and then came back up to Massachusetts where the mills had opened up here again. And they worked in the mills here again.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, did you have any brothers and sisters? How was your life way back in those days?
Yeah, I had two brothers, a younger brother and an older brother. And it was Harold and Robert. Harold was the older. And he was 7 years older than me, so he was not associated with us too much. He had a kind of a separate
kids,
life.
Huh? Yeah. All right.
But Bob and I hung together pretty good.
Okay.
Throughout our teen years.
What did you do as kids? Way back in junior high and high school and so forth. What was your life like? How did you keep busy? What did you do to keep happy?
Mainly we had games. We played games together.
What kind?
Like Relivio.
Oh.
You know, like you draw a circle around by a building.
Mm-hmm.
And you... So it's half the team was inside the circle and half of it was outside. And the ones outside would try to pull the people out of the... And it was kind of a battling.
Okay.
And it was quite an active fighting thing.
Well, now, for example, this area today, as you know, we're having all kinds of snowstorms. But did you have any winter activities down there, like skiing or sledding? Snowball fights, ice skating?
Snowball fights was very common. We were always fighting with the snow. And and later in life, I did become a skier, and I did a lot of skiing. And became quite a good skier.
Good.
And
just a recreational skier?
Ski all the mountains in New Hampshire.
How many?
All the mountains. Any mountain hill that had snow, I'd ski it.
Okay, great.
It was enjoyable to go to different ones.
Did you put any time in a ski patrol?
In the what?
Did you put any time in on the National Ski Patrol, the area patrols?
Oh, no. I just liked to ski. I didn't get involved in any of those programs.
Okay, just being nosy.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, how'd you do in school? Do you anything, any sports, any activities, any clubs?
No, actually, I wasn't involved in any sports activities from school. But I used to play, you know, pick up baseball and pick up football. And we had a lot of, get a bunch of kids together and they divide them into two and they'd each become a team.
Uh-huh.
And we'd play games. We'd
now,
play
to that point,
baseball.
Giving you a chance to brag, were you always picked first or were you the last one?
Was always.
How were you picked? Were you in the first one the people wanted to have or the last one left and they had to take
it? I was pretty much up in the front there.
Okay, I kind of thought
you
were.
Because I was a very active boy.
Yeah. How about ice hockey? You ever play hockey?
I never was into hockey. I loved to skate, but I didn't care for hockey.
I'm just being nosy.
I figure skating. I liked figure skating. I tried to learn to be a good figure skater, but that was I wasn't involved with hockey.
Oh, now to that one point, I'm not going to kill it. But were you in a skating club, in an arena, or just outside in a cold rink someplace?
Usually, what they would do is the firemen would come and flood a field.
Okay.
And we'd have a nice. Well, they, you know, they put up a little ditch around it, and they'd make a skating area, in almost every neighborhood.
That was all outdoors, though. There weren't any warm-up hats or anything like that.
No.
You'd be surprised. Some of the kids
today. They didn't have any special things. You kept warm by skating a lot.
Uh-huh. Ever have fires along the edge where you change your shoes into your skates?
Oh, yeah. Sometimes it would be in an old baseball field, so there'd be a bench there, you know, where you could sit out and change your skate. And we did a lot of skating as kids.
Good.
And I became a skier later on. And
how late later on?
Oh, probably
in your teens or in your age? And
I was probably 12 or 14 when I started skiing.
Okay.
And
good enough.
Then eventually I skied all the mountains in New Hampshire.
One. I envy that.
I love to ski.
Wonderful. I know. Right now there's too damn much snow. If you read the paper today, folks, Boston is being threatened with another blizzard. We've had two or three in the last 3 weeks. We have more ski. They'll be probably skiing till July or August, I think.
The kids will love it.
Yeah, the trouble is, we have no place to put it to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Okay, now, after school, when did you have to really start working to help the family along?
Working to what?
When did you go to work?
Oh, I was pretty young when I started working, probably around 12 or so.
Okay, so you worked.
I had a paper route before that.
Okay.
And then I started working in the mills, the wood mill, and I was a back boy.
Okay. As we said before, tell us, what is a back boy? What are you doing? How well did you do
it? There's these spinning frames. They ran right across the whole building, and they had hundreds of what they call roving, which was the soft thread about this thick, and it would be fed down through and wouldn't go on to the spinning, the spinning frame, which was run in and out. And as it ran out, it would spin, and then it would wind it onto the bobbin. There were wires that guided it.
Okay.
And a wire ran all the way along. And one would hold it down, and the other would hold it up, and they would wind. It would wind.
That's where you get that shape like that on all the spindles.
Yeah.
Or bobbins.
The bobbins in the back were thick because that was the roving, which was about this diameter.
All right.
And it would spin it down into a thread, a regular thread, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And and it would wind it on a little bobbin. And those were, they would doff them, they called it, pull them off. And they were paper cones that they were, that the threads were wrapped on. These paper cones fit onto the spindles. And the spindles would wrap it on.
Mm-hmm.
And when it got all full, they would call in the doffer. The guy would pull all
take
those
off.
Off and put them in a barrel, and they'd go to the weave room.
Now, how did you reload it?
Oh, you would put the little paper things on the spindles, little paper cones on
top. Yeah, and how'd you attach the thread?
They would put a wrap on, and the people that did that were spinners and joiners, they were called.
Oh, everybody had their own little...
And I was a back boy, so I didn't do that.
Oh.
And I would, the back boy is the one who had to reload all the,
all right.
the soft threaded roving on. And there was a tray on the top, and you used to pile them up three high, these bobbins that were this big around. And we would pile them up, and then as the bobbins were used up that were on the frame, they would put it
down. More down.
And put more on.
Now, you had to work pretty fast, didn't you, to keep
that it? That was what the back boy did.
Yeah, now how many spindles did you have to cover?
Oh.
15, 20, dozen?
Oh, no, like, we're talking maybe 100 or 200.
Up and down?
There were three rows of them.
Yeah, but I mean...
And they were ran right across the whole mill.
Okay. But you didn't go from end to end, did you?
Yeah. Well, you put the new roving on the spindle.
Yeah.
And threaded it down through, and then it would come out, and the spinner would get the end of it and put it on the spinning spindle. And it would eventually fill up the...
Now, I remember seeing in some of the older photographs, pictures of the early mills with all kinds of kids, 8, 10, 12 years old, going back and forth. This is long before they had child labor laws, I guess. But
How many
years did you work at that? Or did you just stay in that one job or go to a different progression?
Until I went in the Army.
Okay. Which is back, 42?
Yeah, I was... 17, 18, or something like that.
Now, when you got through high school, did you work from there until you went in the Army, or did you go right into the Army?
Actually, I didn't go to high school.
Oh?
I went to night school, night high school.
And worked during the day?
Yeah.
Kind of busy, huh?
Yeah.
Now, did your brothers work at the same mills, too, or didn't they have to work?
Yeah.
So everybody was working...
Everybody I knew worked in the mills.
You had them work in the mill, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Now...
That was the American Woolen Company, the wood mill and the air mill in Lawrence.
Could be, as I say, I'm not used to this end of the world, so it's your story. This is your life, really, okay?
Yeah, the wood mill is a mile long.
And like they have
in
Manchester,
in two sections.
Along the rivers.
Yeah, it's right, this side was right on the river.
Okay.
And this side was on the street that went...
Are they water powered by the river water system or something else?
The water was used to wash. That's why they were located there, because the Merrimack River is soft water. It doesn't have no hard minerals in it. So that's why the mills are located there.
Oh, good point. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. I've learned something today.
Yeah, hard water has a lot of minerals in it,
okay.
And it's not good for... washing the cloth.
But now, if there were other, as we know in New England, a lot of mills along a river, is there any chance of the one up top, the first one, polluting the rest of the water for the people after them? How do you control that? Or didn't they know it back in those days?
Yeah. There was a lot of pollution from the wool. It was dirt and grease
mm-hmm.
from the sheep.
Yeah.
And the rivers were smelly from the sheep grease.
Yeah. All right, I'm just trying to figure it. I don't want to get in a dumb question. When did you go in the Army? And what choices did you make as to when or why did you feel you had to go in the Army?
Well, it was World War II, and everybody was joining up, so I joined up.
Okay, any particular branch?
I joined the infantry.
When?
1942, December.
Okay. Now, the classic question, when you went from civilian to GI, to it the first couple of days or the first week or two in boot camp, what were your reactions? How did you feel? Happy, confused, lost, excited, or what? Just relive those days for us.
It was a bit confusing to begin with, but then you fell right into line and did your job. They gave you a job to do and you did it.
Like example, what kind of jobs?
Well, I was in the infantry.
No, I mean, when you first went in the Army, I was the first week or so, you said you had jobs to do, like getting your clothes, getting your shots in different KP and that kind of stuff. Oh, give us a story on that.
Well, that was at the induction area.
Well, that's what I'm trying to find, at the beginning.
After the induction, okay. You got all your shots and you got your uniforms and you got everything, and then they put you in a unit.
Okay, now what camp were you in when you did it? Where were you inducted in?
Camp Maxey, Texas.
How'd you get there?
By train.
From where?
From
Boston, Manchester?
Lowell, I think.
From Lowell?
Lowell, down to Boston, and down to Texas.
Okay. How'd you feel when you got off the train? You heard it along like a whole bunch of people, or?
It was weird.
Okay, that's
the ground was red.
Yeah, okay.
I never saw red clay. Ground. It was red. I said, well, we're getting off on the moon, folks.
The natives probably didn't like that.
Yeah.
Okay, now how were you greeted when you first got off the train? They said, would you please come this way?
We formed
or some
up
guy
into
barked at you?
No, we formed up in units, got on trucks, and they took us out to the camp.
Okay.
Camp Maxey.
How'd you get there? By truck or march?
Truck.
All right.
Yeah, they trucked us out, and they had these units, there's barracks.
Mm-hmm.
There was like a fire break between this street and that street. Between each set of barracks, there was a fire break, an open area. And that's where we used to drill and everything. And where we would form up during the evening for the evening ceremonies and so forth.
What was the evening ceremony?
Retreat.
Okay, and
it
what happened then?
It's called retreat.
No, I mean, I'm trying to be nosy.
The bugle would play, and they would call us to attention. And,
all right.
And we would...
And draw down the colors?
Yeah. And put
okay,
the colors
and then,
down.
Okay, company dismissed. Then when you were dismissed, what did you do then? Time to do laundry, write letters?
We went back, and we got our mess gear and went to eat. We had... Do you know what the Army mess gear looks like?
Yeah, a plate, like, a canteen, and some spoons.
Like actually, two plates.
Yeah. The cover's the top plate.
Yeah, and there's a handle that snaps them together. And usually there's a metal cup that you
hang
wear
on
in your
side.
Canteen. Yeah. And we would go down to the mess hall and eat.
Now, did they serve
in
you?
In some places, they had regular utensils.
That's what I was trying to get at. Some places were fancy. They had trays and knives and forks.
Yeah, and plates and cups and saucers. But some places you had to bring your mess gear.
Mm-hmm. Now, remember that there used to be a joke about this. You had meat, gravy, and so forth. Then they put the ice cream on top of the mashed potatoes. You ever had that happen to you? Or spill a cup of coffee in your pocket?
Our cooks are pretty good.
How was the food, in your opinion?
Very good. My mother wasn't the greatest cook, so.
Oh, yeah.
I had no problem with
it.
Army food was good.
Did you put any weight on or lose weight the first couple of months?
I think I gained a little bit.
Yeah.
Because I was very young and very active.
Now, what did they give you in the way of, I'm trying to flesh out something here, exercise as far as PT, marching and that kind of stuff. Where and when did you do that kind of drilling?
Well, every morning when you got up, they would have a PT session. You know, you form up in your regular ranks.
Yeah,
and
in
then
front
they would
of your building.
You out and you would get into the, like in two lines, and then you would do the exercises.
Okay. And then what, after that? Do you go to special schools?
Well, then you would go back, take a shower, and get dressed for the day. And we would do our exercises, and then we would go and get our uniforms on for the day and go down and eat, and then go off to classes.
What kind of classes?
Well, they taught you all those different things about the Army, like how to assemble and disassemble a rifle or a machine gun. And there's a lot of classes that they taught. And
what did you decide, or who decided for you, what branch you were going to go in, what kind of activities you were going to do?
I don't remember being asked anything. They just put me where they wanted me.
Okay, so you were shuffled. Where did they put you?
I particularly asked to go to the infantry when I first went in, and that's where they sent me, the 102nd Division, Infantry Division in Texas. And the 407th Infantry Regiment is what I ended up in G Company. And
What were your assignment? Were you a rifleman, a platoon
leader?
I
was a rifleman.
Okay. Would you
crack? That's what I asked for, because that's what I like to do. I love to shoot rifles.
Oh, okay.
That's what I did.
When you were a kid, did you do any hunting?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, you didn't tell us that.
Yeah, I hunted and fished. And, I lived in South Lawrence, and there was a lot of woods and stuff beyond that, Ten Rock Park and all of that.
Did you qualify as a sharpshooter, marksman, expert?
I think I was I think I finally made expert. It wasn't right away.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. There's three categories. I've forgotten what they were, but one was marksman.
Okay, marksman, expert, and regular, if you will.
Yeah.
All right.
Anyway, there's three categories, and eventually I became an expert.
Okay. Now, that was what, the old 03s?
What?
The 1903? The rifle.
What? Oh, yeah, 30-06.
The old Springfield.
Yeah, Springfield's, the M1.
M1?
M1 rifle.
Okay, all right, because we got carbines.
Yeah, M1 rifle was had an 8-shot clip.
Yeah.
That's what we were
issued. Okay. How about bayonet practice? How did you like that?
I was good at it. I was very good at it.
You get real angry and nail them.
Short thrust, long thrust.
Yeah, parry and pray. Yeah.
All the different butt strokes and all of that. Yeah, they taught us very well how to use them.
Now, you said in some of the paper.
When I went in, the banner was this.
Oh, yeah.
The blade was that long.
I know.
They shortened it down to
reasonable length. You get it stuck every once in a while. You get a Now, after a while, you said in our early interview that you applied for the Air Corps. When did that take place?
Well, I got tired of marching after about 6 or 8 months, and I applied for the Air Corps. I thought I'd like to fly. And so I transferred to the Air Corps, and I got through primary flight and basic flight, and they shut the program down about halfway through basic flight. They put everybody on the ground forces.
Did you get your wings? Did you solo get your wings or no? They cut you off before then?
No. I got wings later, but I was in basic flight when they shut the program down.
Okay, now where'd you go? Maxwell Field or someplace like that for primary?
It was in the Carolinas.
Oh?
Yeah. Winston-Salem area, around there. And there was a primary flight, was a two-wing.
A biplane,
flight,
yeah.
A biplane. And then there was a basic trainer, which had fixed landing gear. And then I never got to, I went about halfway through that. And then there was the advanced with the
retractable gear. Ever play
faster,
a mono
much
wing?
Faster. Yeah, they were mono wings, yeah. The basic trainer and the, but the basic trainer had fixed landing gear. You didn't have to put the landing gear down.
They get bumpy if you come down too hard too, didn't they?
Yeah, well, if you didn't land.
Yeah, nose in first.
Yeah, if you didn't pull up and.
Yeah, and stall out.
Yeah, you had to stall, yeah. You had to learn to do that and do it well.
Now, where did they then put you when they killed the program? Where did you go back? Back to the infantry or what?
They put me in the combat engineers. I don't know why.
Well, they wanted
they needed,
somebody.
They needed combat engineers.
You were a body. They wanted you.
Yeah,
okay.
They,
now, what?
They were filling, I ended up in the 283rd Combat Engineer Battalion.
Now, what were your duties then? What training did you have now?
Oh, they taught us a lot about mines and stuff, planting mines and taking mines out and stuff like that.
Well, but stuff like that, most of us don't know what stuff like that means. What specifically, for example? Say, do you have a landmine or something hanging on a tree or something dropped from the sky?
Oh, no. Landmines are dug into the ground.
Yeah.
And there's tank mines and anti-personnel mines.
Now, how did you go scouting for mines? Did they have these sound things, or you had to go with the bayonet?
Use a bayonet.
Okay, tell us about that from a guy who had to do it.
And you had to put it at an angle, and when you hit a clink, you know, when it hit the metal of the mine,
yeah,
then you would dig around. And you had to dig around because there was fuse. They could mount fuses on the side
mm-hmm.
and underneath.
Yeah.
So what you would do is we were very practical. We would just, it had a handle. We had a rope, 100-foot long rope, and with a metal hook on it,
mm-hmm.
and we just yank them out.
Oh.
And if they
so
blew
that's
up,
why you became a Yankee.
Yeah.
A bad.
Yeah. But anyway, that's what we did.
Now, were you allowed to do that, really? Were you allowed to tie a rope and just yank it, as opposed to having
nobody
to dig?
Nobody came near us when we were dealing with mines.
Oh, I don't imagine.
The officers stayed way back.
Way back. Okay, that's fine.
We were expendable, you know, we're only PFCs.
I
know. Yeah, they kept out of the way while we were doing that. Everybody stayed clear of us.
Okay, you can be kind of dangerous. But other than that, what other kind of training did you have? Or were you specifically going in there to be a miner or a snapper?
No, actually, we built bridges and we built roads.
What did that
roads.
Mean? What did that take?
Huh?
How do you build a bridge? With what? What do you use?
Well, they were erector sets, big erector sets.
Okay.
And there was like panels on the sides, and there were stringers that connected them across. And what you'd do is you'd build sections. And they had big pins, this big around, about that long.
Mm-hmm.
And the pins would go into holes on between, there would be like two pieces like this with a hole on each side.
Okay.
And a hole in this one coming this way. And you just put the pin through and it would join the two pieces together.
Very good. Now then, how did you get them in position? You had to use a crane or a winch or bulldozer?
We had rollers. There was like a three rollers on a thing. It was a platform with three rollers on a thing that went
okay.
up and down.
And they'd mount underneath?
And we would put a section on two rollers and roll it towards another section.
Okay, now how'd you roll them? Some guys have to push, or do you have a bulldozer or something?
Group of guys would be pushing them.
Ooh, that's kind of heavy work in a swampy place.
Yeah, we were hard workers.
You ever lose anybody downstream as you get one piece out, they would the car would take it away?
Yeah, as soon as we got one section built, we would roll it out, and then we'd join another one on and roll it out. Mm-hmm. And when you got it far enough over, we had one, the front section would be tilted up. There would be like a little piece that was put into.
Like a bow.
So that it would slide onto the other side.
Now, how'd you get it across? Or you have to have a line over there and guide it back in?
Yeah, there would be. Yeah, we get a gang together and get it across.
Now, how often did you do that?
All the time.
Okay. Now, was that what you did when we, well, now let's get you overseas. Where and when did you leave for the overseas? Roughly, within a year.
Well, let's see, it was 42 is when I went in, December 42. Yeah. So probably 6 months later, I went overseas.
Okay.
I went to England.
Where'd you go? How'd you get there?
By troop ship.
How was your trip over? How was the trip going over?
Fairly uneventful. I used to just stand around. It was a troop ship, you know, like a it was like an ocean liner, only it was.
Only it wasn't private.
The amenities.
I know. I've been there.
Just a bunk and a place to sleep, and mainly we stayed out on deck and kind of looked around.
What time did you go, in the summertime or the wintertime when you went over?
I think it was fall. It was
okay,
like
so did you pick up any of the damned Atlantic storms?
It was a pretty smooth sailing.
Okay, now you go by convoy, separate trip?
Yeah, it was a convoy.
And how was that?
I don't know. We just sailed out of New York Harbor. I remember seeing the Statue of Liberty. And we ended up over in southern England.
Where? In Portsmouth?
It might have been Portsmouth, yeah.
Okay, I'm pumping.
Yeah, it was on the bottom of England, I remember. Okay. And then we got off and we went up to the middle of England.
Where'd you go?
To a camp near Manchester.
Oh, now we heard that name before, Manchester. All right.
Yeah.
Now, when you were there, how were you treated? When you started, if you will, training to get going into France and so forth? What was your training like while you were there in Manchester, prior to going onto the continent?
All the training engineers go through, like we would plant minefields and take them out, and we would build barbed wire fences, and all the things that engineers do.
No, okay.
And we would fix roads, dig out gutters on the side, you know, and all of that,
mm-hmm.
and crown the road. And
well, what was your duty specifically? What was your MOS? Were you a equipment operator or just a grunt?
No, I was just a...
Just a body?
Just a body. Oh. Did all the jobs that needed to be done.
The expendable ones.
Yeah.
Okay, then how'd you get into France? How and when did you get to France?
We went to southern England and got on a troop ship and went across. And I remember when we got to Cherbourg, we went through the town and went up on the hill above Cherbourg and camped up there till they got ready for us to go down to Lorient.
Okay.
And they had troops, German troops, surrounded in Lorient. And we served on that line for a while. And then we were shipped to Germany, and
shipped to Germany or
to Cologne.
All right.
And on the Rhine River, and we were just outside of Cologne and camped there.
What kind of activities did you do there? What were your activities there? Were you under fire in combat on the line, or your support troops?
Actually, we did mostly training, because there was no fighting going on at that time. The fighting had just ended when we got there.
The end of 44?
They were all the way over to the Czechoslovakian border. And so we eventually went over there too.
Was that where you were when the war ended in there?
That's okay. Where I was.
Now, what kind of action did you have any times when you were doing your pontooning, bridging, and so forth? Were you under fire?
No. No, we never got into combat.
Okay, just
that
fine.
That was good. We were happy.
Hey, amen. Amen to that, brother.
We just missed it.
Okay.
We were just behind it.
That's good.
And yeah, we were a little late getting in there.
Okay.
And that was
well,
good.
When the war was over, when did you come home? When did you come back to the States? Sometime 45?
I remember being sent down to the southern France and got on a troop ship there and came home.
Okay. Again, a pleasant trip, private staterooms, air conditioned?
No, it was pretty.
Well, where'd you come back
central.
To? What? Where did you land when you came back home? New York, Boston?
It was New York, because I remember taking the train up to Albany from New York City.
Mm-hmm.
And then from Albany, we went over to Massachusetts.
Now, when you got back home, did you take advantage of the GI Bill? You about get more schooling?
Yes, I did.
Tell us about that.
Well, I signed up Boy, my memory is failing. But it was Lowell Tech.
Okay, that rings
so
a bell.
I signed up in Lowell Tech.
What was your course major?
Manufacturing engineering.
Okay.
And that's what I became, a manufacturing engineer.
When you graduated, where'd you go to work?
In the mills in Lawrence, the wood mill and the air mill.
Okay, we talked earlier about you going up to a mill up in Maine College up there.
Yeah. And also there was the Monomac Mill, which was like the main mills were on the Merrimack River. And the Monomac was here on the other side of Lawrence. And I worked there for a while.
Were they Raytheon, some of those companies?
The Monomac was a separate outfit.
Because you did say earlier you had gone to work for Raytheon.
Yeah, we did. I worked for Raytheon in the valley. That's between Lawrence and Haverhill. And there's a plant down there in the valley.
What kind of work did you do there?
What I was trained to do, I planned workstations and set them up and got people working and supervised.
Say you mean machines or what was the workstation consist of?
Hand operations of putting parts together.
Oh, okay, all right. Yeah.
And they would be like 6 or 10 people building a unit,
mm-hmm.
and they would start putting parts together here and more parts and
that's
more parts.
That's what they go on. Okay.
Finally, they would.
How long did you do that?
I don't know, a couple of years, I guess.
Okay.
3 years. Yeah.
When did you retire? When did you retire and say the heck with it all and enjoy life?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, now easy question. What kind of a family did you have when you come home, and what kind of kids? How many kids?
I had a son and two daughters.
Okay.
And
they live around locally. You get to see them.
Yeah, well, my son died, but.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
But my. Two daughters are still alive, and I see them.
Now they take care of you now?
Not really. I take care of myself.
Okay, but when we get of a sudden the kids take over. I just wanted.
No, they visit. And I love them, but.
Okay. But, all right. Let me ask you a question. With all that you've seen and done and been exposed to, would you say that your experience in the service was positive and negative as how it helped you develop
Very
your
positive.
Life?
Very positive. Very positive.
In what manner? Can you give any idea or examples?
Well, I learned to do stuff. I learned to do things. I learned to put things together. I learned how to supervise people.
Now about your own personal life. Did you learn anything about yourself? It's a dumb question, but it's a tricky question.
I came to realize I was fairly intelligent, more intelligent than most of the people around me. Sorry to say.
It's a good answer. Humility is not your strong point.
Yeah.
Now that's good to know.
Yeah.
Good to know.
I used to take over and make things happen.
Very good. Now, the way the economy is today, this is a...
I was a manufacturing engineer.
All right.
And a senior manufacturing engineer.
Well, you're a senior now, too.
Now I am very senior.
One thing, any kind of words of advice or you want to give the kids coming up today that may or may not benefit if they were to go into the service? Well, not recruiting, but the opportunities that they can have to learn something, learn a trade, learn a skill, or develop themselves.
Well, I don't know how much, when I was in, you didn't have a lot of choices. You could ask for and get certain jobs. But, yeah, and they kind of like that. They kind of like to want to do something.
Yeah. You know? Well, it's easier for them. It gave you a chance to control what you're doing.
Yeah. And they were very cooperative in... With me, I know.
Okay.
And I enjoyed my time in the service.
All right. There you go. Okay. Who's this dude?
That's me.
When? Way back
yeah,
when?
That's when I was in the infantry. Yeah.
Okay. Now, is that what, 1942?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, December of 42.
Where is this now? This is in France, Germany?
Yeah, that's in Germany, yeah.
Okay.
In the town of Frecken. By Cologne.
Okay.
Yeah, they say by Cologne in German.
Here we go.
Yeah, that's when I was in the Air Corps.
Now, what does that take now, Maxwell Field?
Let's see. I did spend some time at Maxwell Field, but I was in the Carolinas when I was flying.
Okay, all right, I'm just trying to get a just, and any more pictures? Three words. Thank you, friend. Glad to have you, glad for your service, and come back and see us, all right?
I was a very happy serviceman.
Good. Smiley.
I really liked it.
Good. Well, that's a wrap, folks. For those of you who may be on the cusp, we'll ask you again if you've served and can meet the simple qualification to come here and join us in the program. The basic thing, again, as I've said before, it's unfortunate, but it's true. We're fighting the clock and the calendar. Another couple of years, months or so, guys of our age will be a WASA veteran. The thing that I am concerned about is a lot of guys keep saying, oh, yeah, I'll think about it and I'll do it tomorrow. The problem is none of us knows which tomorrow is going to be our last. I'm not being morbid, but it's a statement of fact. We're fighting the clock and the calendar. And if you don't tell your story, nobody else will. And we've lost that, but more important, you're depriving your friends and your family particularly of a tie between you and what made you yourself. Again, the address will be on the back of the program. And if you can and will, give us a call. Bob Stevens saying thank you, stay well, stay healthy.